rocking with the disco fries, blowing out your mother speakers, period. That's what it is. Disco fries in the building, and you know something? It's going to get done to you right now. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. Yeah, it happens right now. The disco fries are on the set. Let's go.
Yo, you got it.
Nice. You already got it.
Snagged it.
I love it. Yeah, got some.
Listen to that mix I put together.
Yo, you did more DJ mixes in 1 week than a man should ever have to do in 1 week.
We haven't done them in forever, and then we were just like, let's knock out like five.
Yeah, that was intense. That's why I said to you, you're banned from doing them for a little while. I have to pick up the slack. Yo, shout out to
Mooshock listening while cutting the grass. I should be cutting the grass. Mine is a jungle right now.
But no, you're on vacation.
Yeah, that's true. It'd be difficult to cut my grass from 3 hours away.
I'm actually finishing an email blast for this show right now, as we speak, because it's been that kind of week.
Inception.
And I don't,
yeah, dude.
I don't really care.
Nick has shielded me from the overwhelming majority of what goes on behind the scenes to organize a drop. Because we had all the collectibles, but it's like quality control checks. And
yo, the thing I liken it to is, now thinking about it, is when we did the autonomous EP. And yeah, you remember when we had to get like all that crazy art together for the iTunes Deluxe Edition, and then there was like 11th hour licenses where territories had to get pulled. That's what it felt like.
Yeah. No, that's exactly what I thought about. Like, the drop is weird in a different way. It feels like putting an album together, but in a different way, because just like the type of assets we're putting together and the like creativity behind it, like trying to think of different ways to like incentivize people to seek out certain collectibles and stuff, is not something you're doing on a traditional release.
Yeah, no, not at all. So I don't even know that the Medium article is up yet, but that'll lay out, anybody who's watching from Record Shop or that's going to go collect this pack, which we'll tell you about in a second, the Medium article will be really helpful in getting you to understand what's in it and what's happening with it. So let me just put this up really quick. That's it.
Nice.
It's going down right now. I'm going to pop the link in here. The pre-sale's live now. The full drop is next week. But if you get in on the pre-sale, hopefully you get a lower serial, you get your slot in line, and you get a free collectible today. So I think we'll just walk through it real quick before we bring our awesome guest on. And let me just pull this link. We're just rolling through a 2DB playlist right now. So shout out to 2DB. Listen, guys,
when it's out
this kind of week, certain attention to detail gets lost.
Bilious, I don't even know what you're talking about. That's where you're opening your packs? It's a good conversation starter.
I'm looking for his thing. Gazillion packs bought. My preferred location will be a strip club. A midget one. Get ready to party. Love it. All right, man. Cool. Sounds like you're going to have a good weekend.
Yeah, man.
Nice. All right. So I'll share my screen. And do it like this. It's coming, I promise. Oh, great. Chrome has lost permission to capture your screen. System preferences.
Oh, it's going to make you quit, isn't it?
I'll do it from a different browser. Google doesn't like me, and I don't like Google. Lodato's here. He was just texting me. He goes, first he just opens up with hi. I love when people do that.
Hi.
Then he
says, if people open up with hi, you don't know if a big ask is coming or.
Yeah, it's pretty open-ended. And then he goes, you're kind of busy today, right? And I was taking a shit at the time, so I technically wasn't busy in that moment. But little crazy day. All right, I got it working over here.
Oh, Phileas. Okay, yeah, you scout out San Diego. You scout out the greater San Diego area for the top. We want three options of little people strip clubs that we can all party at together.
Little people strip clubs.
Is that what you look up when you go into Yelp? Is that how you find the best ones? Or TripAdvisor, I guess.
Must be. All right, this is making me run through this. So you guys got to just chill for a second. Hang on. I'll walk you through it. So it says go to system preferences, unlock the screen by selecting the lock at the bottom left. No, I don't want to go through all this, man.
Urban Owl knows Lil Bo Peeps in San Diego.
This is frustrating.
Radio Dave wants to know, how does one become a wristband holder?
You don't need a wristband.
One. You need a wristband.
We don't know Kenny G personally, but we now know him personally. And so there's a nice shout out video. That's one of the rewards in this. Danny, you have no way to do a screen share on there, do you? Nothing.
Well, unfortunately, I'm going to run into the same issue where it's going to ask me permissions. Open. Let me see if it'll do it. I mean, I can hop off for 2 seconds.
Yeah, hop off because I think it's worth showing this real quick.
Yeah, let me get this. I will be right back.
Sweet. All right, guys. So if you're just stepping in, we have an awesome guest on today who we're going to bring up in a few minutes. He's been chilling backstage like a champ. He is a music industry veteran, knows plenty about songwriting, production, has some really cool collabs coming up. Hopefully he's got one with us soon. We got to work on that. I always love watching people backstage too, the faces they make while nobody else can see them except for us. He is also a Web3, I don't want to even say veteran because Web3 hasn't been around long enough for there to necessarily be veterans. I'll just say he's an expert in Web3 and he knows a lot and can share a lot of information. So I met him in a Twitter Spaces and his name is A-SHO. So I'm going to bring A-SHO up. That way we can chat a little bit while we work out these technical problems. Then we'll walk through our pre-sale on Record Shop a little bit and we'll keep the party going. So here he is, A-SHO. What's up, man?
Doing well, sir. Thank you for having me.
What's going on? Thanks for coming on.
Pleasure to be here. Can you guys hear me okay? Is everything smooth? Yeah? Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to turn down this music a little bit so we can actually have a chat.
Awesome.
Yeah, great. So Danny's working on hopefully fixing probably one of the easiest, should be the easiest problems for us to figure out, which is just screen sharing on Twitch. Pretty basic.
Those permissions will get you. Google Meets and Zoom, I get screwed every single time. So I feel you.
Yeah. Phileas Foggs, who's a big Fried Fam member and collector, said what's up. He's big into the NFT space. He also runs a pub in San Diego. So we got to get there soon.
I love it.
So hang on real quick. I'm just going to hit Danny. Danny, yep. Do you want to stay off stage? Are you?
Let me just check. I'm in, and it looks like I can share my screen now.
Oh, sick. So A-SHO, real quick, because this will be cool for you to see anyway, because I know you were asking some stuff about Record Shop earlier in the week. We're going to walk through real quick how to grab a free collectible, which is up right now. The pack we just dropped, we're dropping next week, is up for pre-sale right now. So you can buy it, but you don't actually get it until it mints fully next week.
Yeah. All right, let's see if this how this looks here. Dun, 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 dun. All right.
Oh, you did it.
Yeah, you can add it there, Nick. I can't because I'm not logged in. Cool. All right, so here we are. Let's get... Oh, no, we already authorized you. There we go. Friends of Fries.
Nice. So,
buy the pack.
Shout out to Laura for doing that art, by the way. It's awesome.
Yeah, it looks sick. Maybe you could explain, because it says pre-sale for wristband holders. I wasn't aware I was a wristband holder. I just went ahead and clicked buy pack.
All right, well, that means a message has to go to somebody real quick. It says pre-sale for wristband holders.
But people are going to want to know, how do you get a wristband?
Yeah, I know. Well, you don't need a wristband.
Oh, all right. Obviously, since I picked it up with that one.
Yeah, so that's just text that doesn't need to be there.
There you go. And yeah, as soon as you get it, you in your collection, go to my collection, and it'll pop up where this at the bottom here. So you get this Welcome to Fried Fam collectible, little note.
I like that you got a whole number, a nice 1200.
Yeah, 1200. I was like, yo, we got Nick talking.
Side by side.
And then we got a 30-minute like little mini mix, which is just like a little preview of some of this stuff. There's like a longer mix in the pack, and this is like a little preview of that kind of.
Yeah, so that's the freebie for today when you sign up and you claim that. And so did you buy a pre-sale pack yet?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, you did? And so you
yeah, so that's how right I already away. Have the collectible in my collection.
But you can actually claim one without buying anything. If you wanted to just be that guy, you can do that. You could start a collection today with one free collectible.
And how do you do that? You just come down here, go to where it says buy the pack. And
well, if you were a new user, it would prompt you to sign up. Oh,
gotcha. And you just, yep. And you just connect a social to it and then
yep,
you get it for free.
That's the link I dropped in earlier in here somewhere.
Nice.
Yeah, here it is again, guys, just so you have it. So anyway, we're really excited about this pack. Drops next Friday. Got our buddies Modern Machines, Vic, Bexy, Tondo, 1988. Who else is in it? 10 Steps, Big Knob. So
Big Knob.
Am I on mute? I think you're...
No. On the screen share, it had your video, but no one can hear you but me.
Yeah, that's Ed's a fan of that. Of
Ed's busting balls.
All right. So anyway, that's the story. Jump over to the record shop. It's happening now. And here he is. A-Show's here, by the way.
Hey. Man. I'm so impressed how you guys are this education piece of NFTs and collectibles is so important, and how you guys are using Twitch essentially to just literally just walk through everybody right now on the spot on how to purchase is brilliant. So shout out to you guys.
Oh, thank you, man. Well, it's funny because like a lot of the people on here are already on the Record Shop platform, so they're familiar with it. But that's one of the things that I loved about it from the jump was just how easy it was. Like you didn't have to have like a crypto wallet set up or anything. I know their payment system has changed a little bit. You can still use a credit card. When I first got on, you could do Apple Pay. So it was like 5 seconds barrier to entry and I was on, which is pretty cool. And now that they've got like the sound token sort of thing, like they're working in a coin economy to it. I feel like it helps people get into that Web3 crypto NFT space in a very approachable way where they can like kind of grow from there.
I love it. I love it. And I love how you added the mix and, yeah, it's, I've been a fan of Record Shop from way back, like when they were kind of just starting to talk about it and to build it. I had a conversation with Obi and, just super innovative. And like, I love that it's dance music, you know, myself as a like EDM vocalist kind of primarily, to find, you know, other kind of dance artists in the space that are like really pioneering the music NFT space from what I've seen so far, like obviously Blau, you know, you guys are killing it. it's really exciting. So yeah, I love it, man. Keep killing it. And I'm definitely going to cop a little collectible right after this.
Yeah. Are you going to end up minting some collectibles on there, or does that go against, is that a conflict of interest with Nifty Tunes?
No way. No conflict of interest. So yeah, we're actually building a platform called Bridge that I kind of briefly mentioned to you in the DMs, but
don't get into it yet, because we gotta go back first. Before we can get to that.
Sounds good. But yeah, definitely gonna do some stuff with Record Shop at some point. I love the platform.
Awesome. So let's talk through like your lineage in music, and then get to Web3 and Nifty Tunes. Why don't you just like give us the synopsis? Take us through a little bit, because I have no idea. I mean, I know we've talked a lot, but like I don't even know your story of how you got here.
For sure. Hey, pleasure to chat and to kind of get into it. Yeah. So basically was previously a wind energy engineer, by trade, went to like school for that, and then was sitting at my 9-to-5 every day and realizing that like, hey, I'm actually not going to be saving the world, unfortunately. I'm just working for a company, and decided that I was going to pursue my passion in music. One thing led to another, like record some demos, got a record deal with Sony here in Canada, and moved from Montreal to Toronto, and I've been here ever since, and did the major label thing for like a year and a half, 2 years, and saw the ups and downs of the industry and how that, and learned a whole bunch, love the team at Sony Canada, and it was just like a really exciting time and very eye-opening. Once that radio single happened and that success happened in Canada here, I couldn't follow it up, and I just didn't have enough, I guess. Yeah. I guess the way that the labels kind of major label industry works is like, once you kind of have a quote unquote hit or top 40 radio hit, you need a follow up, and it kind of has to sound similar to it. I'm sure you guys have been through this before. Yeah. And I just couldn't kind of find that same magic or that same vibe, I guess. And like, I was kind of going in a different direction creatively. That's life. And then one thing led to another, and decided to start my own independent record label called Sad Boy Records. And we've done now 100 million streams in the past 2 years. Signed a bunch of fantastic artists. And I don't know if you guys have heard of Kaiza, we have a song with her, and lots of really good dance artists as well that Canadian based that were able to kind of get their start with our label. And something I'm super passionate about. But and I see Austin Kramer's in the crowd, in the comments, like, dude's literally a legend. So like, thank you for all that you've done for all of us, folks that came up in the dance scene back.
All of us, yeah.
Like literally, bro, low key kind of owe that guy credit for, just having any kind of relevancy in on Spotify. So,
but hang on one second, 100 million streams.
Hey,
that's fucking awesome.
Let's go.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I love awesome. Sound effects. we're distributed by Believe in Canada and Create Music Group in the US. So we have
a deal with Chris.
Not directly with Chris, with Thomas and Darlene. They work on like the Insomniac stuff, and love those guys. Do you guys have ever worked with Create as well?
So Chris from Create and Believe, lives like 5 minutes from me. Like I can walk to his house.
Oh, dope. Okay, Chris from Believe.
Yeah. Cool. Create handles our liftoff stuff for YouTube. So we're close with those guys too. So it's awesome.
I love it. Yeah. Yeah. I forgot that Believe actually now expanded to the US. They have like an office out there, and I love it. So cool. Long story short, the past kind of 6 months have been difficult for on the streaming side of things. It's been just very kind of competitive, oversaturated. And, as the CEO of this independent record label, I wanted to find a new way to kind of jump into new revenue streams. And, we started exploring Sync. So we're working with Disco, which is a really dope platform. I highly recommend it for independent artists to be able to kind of present their music into to music supervisors for Sync. And then also music NFTs kind of started to pop up. So just kind of dove headfirst into that space. Started building, investing, collecting, learning. Now one thing led to another, and we've now kind of built two platforms that are ready to be launched in the near future, which we can get into now, or we can get into later.
Yeah, I'm curious though, before the music NFT stuff, were you collecting NFTs at all, or crypto, and kind of in the space a little?
For sure. So I don't know if you guys have heard of Matt Medved.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Obviously, previously a Billboard dance, and then now he's running an awesome platform called NFT Now. So I kind of was just, always a fan of him, and just like followed kind of what he was doing, saw that he went from 50,000 followers to 150,000 followers on Twitter in the span of a month by essentially just kind of starting to collect music NFTs, and there was all this buzz, and realized that, there's something here. This is interesting. And sorry, not just music NFTs, but NFTs in general, like PFPs and whatnot. So I ended up just, getting acquainted with the space from that, and then bought my first PFP, which is a crypto skull, and got really lucky with that, and was in a Twitter space at the same time that Gary V popped into the Twitter space, and he sweeped the floor, and the whole entire thing just blew up, and I was able to sell immediately. So a lot of because obviously there's a lot of horror stories in PFP projects, and lots of ups and downs and rug pulls, et cetera. But my experience was just super positive, and it was super inspiring to kind of just be oh shit, this is a game changer for, for just an investor in general. And then, adding the music layer to it was a no brainer for me. If we're buying these JPEGs of these, pixelated skulls and these monkeys, why is our art, why are our MP3s that, we put all this, effort into, and then that people consume and people get married to, people listen to at festivals, why should that be valued any less, right? Than these $1 million monkeys and Bored Apes, right? So that's kind of what triggered it for me. And then, yeah, ever since then, I've just been, knee deep in building a team, working with developers and building these platforms.
Nice. That is that's a good entry point in. It's awesome that your first big one was successful. Your first big purchase was successful. That's right. Not the story for everybody.
I'm curious. Did you guys ever collect some PFPs as well?
So my entry point into NFTs, because I was doing crypto for a while, and I still just buy it. I buy a stock, right?
Yep.
I don't do day trading on it really, mm-hmm. because I've gotten burned too many times doing that. But my entry point into NFTs was trying to mint my own on OpenSea just to see what the process was. And this was probably 6 months before I met Obi and Paula from Record Shop. And so I created a piece of art. I went through the process, which is arduous, to mint it. And I was like, this is not scalable the way it is, because it was harder to, everybody was like, Web3, Web3, it's the future. And it was harder to do that in Web3 than it is for me to just upload a picture to Instagram in Web2.
Right.
So I was like, why is this great? So then I started looking into the underlying technology and where it could go. And obviously that changes things a lot. But then when Record Shop came up, I was like, this makes sense to me, because this bridges the gap between what I just tried to do in Web3, which was ridiculous to get a piece of art up on OpenSea, and what's already going on in Web2. And obviously OpenSea's progressed considerably since that time. And it's totally different now with how to mint something, and it's a lot easier. But what Record Shop was doing with bringing in Web2 people with just an undertone of NFT, it layering on an NFT technology. But essentially, when you go on the site, you could be an iTunes user or a Beatport user, and you understand how to use it right away.
Yeah, so is the word NFT really, does it even really even pop up on the Record Shop site? Because I
not
feel like it's not, they don't push it as it is an NFT platform, but I don't think it could get any friendlier in terms of just approachability and ease of access sort of.
Yeah. And I mean, so that was kind of the long and short of my journey. And I'm not sure if Danny had collected anything.
No, I don't collect because whether I like it or not, I always buy high, sell low. And if I just followed Nick's moves, then I would tank all of his investments. So I don't jump on as an investment platform. So I've really just been on Record Shop picking stuff up, supported a bunch of the early drops, but that's about it.
Dope. Very, very cool. I see Urban Owl shouting out Kaleox. Yo, that's crazy. That was like, man, that was back in like 2013, 2014. That dude was like a deep house, like OG that, man. Yeah. Crazy. Cool. Shout out to you, Urban Owls. But yeah, I love the user experience on Record Shop. And I think that like, in order to bring down the barrier to entry into music NFTs, like we need to create that familiar user experience. And right now, like you said, like, you know, OpenSea, it's just so unfamiliar and so different. And, you know, that's why, you know, platforms like sound.xyz that kind of looks and feels like SoundCloud, like that's why that's working. Right. And then,
yep.
You know, I think that there's going to be other platforms that are coming up, you know, including ours that are going to like look and feel like a DSP, right? Where it's like, okay, I remember what iTunes looked like. I remember what Beatport, you know, how Beatport works. Like it's, you know, very similar user experience. So I think that's, you know, a key component to mainstream adoption of like this insane new revenue model for music that like we all need to kind of like really get behind because, you know, streaming is just not enough anymore, you know, to sustain it. Whether you're an independent artist or you're even as a label, like it's just there, we need to start finding different components, different pockets to kind of, you know, create a more well-rounded, balanced ecosystem for artists and for, you know, for all music stakeholders. And you know, music NFTs are going to be a big part of that, I think.
Amen to that. So talk us through Nifty Tunes, like what the structure of that is, how did you put it together? I know you like assembled a team once you figured out the space a little bit, but walk us through it a little bit more.
For sure. So yeah. So Nifty Tunes is a consumer facing, you know, music NFT DSP that lives on the Solana blockchain. Why Solana? You know, similarly to Flow, very, very low gas fees. But yeah, the thing with Solana is obviously it's a layer one. You know, they have a very strong ecosystem already of collectors. And you know, enthusiasts, and there hasn't really been a use case for music specifically on the Solana network yet. Like, you know, you go on Magic Eden, which is like the biggest Solana NFT marketplace. They don't even have a music tab yet the Chainsmokers are like one of their main investors in them. So it's like, it's just a matter of time, you know, for like music to start really popping up on Solana. And like, we wanted to kind of be ahead of the curve on that. But yeah, shout out to Pixel Bands, which is a really dope Solana-based kind of music project that kind
We're supposed to connect with them next week. Mm-hmm. So I've been talking to them on Twitter, and we're just going back and forth, but we're going to find a way to connect next week.
Strongly recommend, yeah, working with those guys. Like, so, so cool, so innovative, and just, like, really good people. And, yeah, like they're really kind of utilizing like the gamification aspect of it, where there's like a battle of the bands aspect where and I think that I think that like the whole point of the only way that like we're really going to find that mainstream adoption is that, like, if we find ways to make this fun, you know, and if we find ways to kind of gamify the experience. But back to Nifty Tunes, like the whole point is like we wanted to create the first completely legacy music industry compliant music NFT DSP. So we're completely DDEC compliant. So we operate with UPC codes, ISRC codes, everything that you would, you know, would run through with your regular distributor. And like similar to Spotify for artists, like, you know, you're going to receive that music metadata and content on your Nifty Tunes for artists, which we're calling Bridge for artists. And you'll be able to then actually allocate you know, which release you'd like to release, you know, onto which platform in Web3. You know, Nifty Tunes is going to be kind of our own baby, you know, on Solana, but like we're already, you know, working with many other platforms to kind of streamline, you know, on various blockchains as well. You know, the whole point is that, yeah, Nifty Tunes is going to be like the first completely compliant music NFT DSP. With the legacy music industry, we're paying out a mechanic. We're operating basically exactly as a digital download would. And that's the reason why we're able to kind of start having these conversations with distributors and labels, because that license infrastructure is like already established, right? Everyone knows what a digital download is. Everyone knows like you have to pay mechanical royalty to, you know, your mechanical rights society. And like, that's really it. It's very simple. And then the rest of the master royalties will go back to the distributor and they'll pay out their artists and their labels. So it really brings down a lot of friction and barriers to entry where, you know, you as an artist now are still releasing music through the comfort of your label or through your distributor without having to like learn all these different platforms and all their different user experiences, right? And just exactly as you know, your content would appear on a regular DSP like Apple Music or Spotify, you know, your content will appear on Nifty Tunes magically, right? Just with a click of a few buttons, without having to go through this tedious process. So yeah, it's exciting. And, you know, I think, there's, you know, lots of buzz in the space right now, but like the concept of like bridging the gap to the legacy music industry and like compliance with the legacy music industry is like being overlooked. And it's instead of building on an island into like this weird kind of like utopian society that we're all hoping to have in Web3, it's like it's just not going to be the case. And like the legacy music industry is going to be the music industry. They're going to keep thriving. They're going to keep making money. And like if we don't make bridges, like this is going to just be a little moment, a little bubble that we're in, and it will never actually. Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if you were in the spaces that I was in last week, but we were talking about that. And so one of the things that came up, just one of the like the loose concepts that came up was, what are those bridges going to be? So I mentioned something like, what if Shazam was on the blockchain, where like you Shazam, because you could Shazam TV commercials, right? So you Shazam a TV commercial. Now it registers that on the blockchain. Maybe it's connected to your wallet somehow. And whatever that commercial was can then just airdrop you an incentive for that product. Or that music artist that was connected to the commercial can also engage you because they have wallet information. So then they could airdrop you the song or something about the record. Like, that's where it gets crazy to me. So I like, you're speaking my language when you're like, if you don't create the bridge, it's fucked.
Exactly.
Yeah. The whole thing is fucked. But I think the smart people are like yourself. So that's awesome.
Cheers. Ditto right back. And you know, that blockchain kind of Web3 Shazam, you should, yeah, you know, if I were you, I would go and patent that, go and, you know, build some flow charts, find some devs, because
let's talk.
You recorded that spaces, right?
Let's talk.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, because that's the thing, is it's interesting how many conversations we have about the Web3 space. And obviously a lot of people are talking about it, but when you step back and look at from like the greater community of like music listeners, it's still like less than 1% that are like even touching this space. Right. And the only way you're going to get the majority of them over, it was the same thing moving from CDs to iTunes, iTunes to streaming. There's kind of like a tipping point, and there's something that needs to happen to make it easy, accessible, and have it make sense for people. So all of these different things like you're both talking about, whether it's using the same tools that you would use to get your music on traditional DSPs, but get it on the blockchain, or something like Nick's talking about, like existing applications that are tapping into the blockchain and just like adding that functionality, that for sure is the way that you're going to get like the general population to start messing around, or at least be like comfortable with the concept. Cause I can't tell you how many people I have conversations with that they're like, yo, I haven't seen you in a while. Like, what are you up to? And then I like hesitantly say like, oh, there's this like NFT platform I'm really excited about, because like everyone already just has these like negative impressions about what it is, because the education just isn't there yet.
Nailed it.
Well, and there's a bad stench in the room around it being like rich white dudes just running the show.
Yeah.
And there is an argument there, right? Like, there is a lack of diversity that's dominating the narrative, and that's what everybody sees. They hear like Bitcoin ruins the planet, you know what I mean? Like, because it what it takes to mine it, and that's what they see up front, because that's the coin with the most value. So I think it's just time. It's time. Oh, like a few years from now, those won't even be considerations. So shout out to Boogie Hill Faders in the chat, by the way.
What up, Boogie Hill Faders? Yeah, no, it's a it's conversations like this, honestly. Like, it's what you guys are doing, and you guys are doing it on such a kind of high like level where you're engaging with your community, and you're offering all these different utilities, and you're making it interesting and exciting, right? And it's like, you know, people like yourselves that are really going to be able to push this space forward. So I know, and just one metric that you kind of touched upon, Danny, is like that 1%, like it's So in 2021, Water and Music posted kind of this research that they did. 310 total artists successfully sold music NFTs and generated over $150 million in 2021. So if you put that into perspective, that's equivalent to 40 billion streams. So from 310 artists, 310 artists, right? And like there's 8 million artists on Spotify. So like imagine what like that opportunity is. And like we actually use that metric in like all of our pitches to investors, and like everyone's like, whoa, okay, so like I can't ignore this because clearly there's an opportunity here, right? But it's like, okay, so now how do we blow that up from 300 to, you know, to like right now, I think I'd say we're sitting at maybe 5,000 total artists, right? You know, Q2 2022, you know, how do we blow this to like a million by this time next year, right? So it's got to be things like that, what you guys are doing and like bringing down barriers to entry and bridging that gap, I think is going to be the only way.
Now here's the challenge, and then I want to talk about more about like your B2B business with distributors and all that, because that's awesome stuff you're doing. Here's the challenge, like with a record shop, which I love the format because it is entry level pricing, like whatever, this pack is going to be $11 for people to get three music NFTs. Some have really good utility, but either way, you're getting exclusive music in the pack, artwork, the whole nine yards for $11. The problem is, because it is so low cost and we want to get people in the door, the ROI for us it's not crazy. So like we're investing tons of time, and if you broke down the hourly, it's not going to get the, like if you were kind of doing an hourly rate, you're not going to get what you'd want. But for us, we see it more in a macro sense of like, this is just the beginning of our journey into all these things. And these people who are supporting the pack are supporting tons of stuff that we're doing. So we're able to keep feeding them more material and more content. And it's great for the brand. Like it's just a win. We learn from it. We learn what works, what doesn't. It's just a big win all around. But there are artists that can't afford to take the time that we've taken on this, that really need to like generate some revenue to just fucking live. So that's, I think, where the hurdle and disconnect could be.
Well, but Nick, the other thing I want to just point out, like as something related to what you're saying, is like, it's easy for artists to spend just as much time making their music and putting it up on Spotify to then not be recognized by editors, not get like, you know, not being in the playlist swap game, like, and it literally just disappears. And, and like, if nothing happens that week, the chances of something happening the following week, it drops off dramatically. So like, at least there's a community around this. So say, you know, with like the storefronts in record shop, when people will be able to mint their own stuff and get it onto the record shop platform, then at least there's a Discord to go on to and not, and like start engaging with people, like find other people that make music similar to you and start connecting with them, whatever. At least there's like some tangible, like there's some way to connect rather than just like get it up. Sure, you can go to CD Baby and you'll get it on, you know, Apple Music, Spotify, Pandora, all of that stuff, but then it's completely out of your control and you're just hoping, unless you've built some connections, you're on a label that has those types of relationships.
No, that's a great point.
Kind of elaborate on that. It's like, I'm curious to know, I guess, how you guys came up with your pricing model, you know, for your guys' drops. Obviously it sounds like you guys are doing this for like the right reasons, obviously, and like you're trying to build that community. And but essentially, like, you know, the whole point is like, I think that, you know, music NFTs are going to kind of provide that gateway for your core fans, for your like actual super fans now, where they have like this really engaged conversation with you directly as an artist, and you know, to be able to unlock certain perks. And I think in my mind, it's like the ability to have that kind of conversation with your core fans first, and then releasing to the DSPs for the sake of discoverability and algorithms, et cetera. I think that revenue model and that like strategy is gonna start to become more and more of a thing, where actually like the revenue that you generate from your NFT drop, then you use that to actually market to new web too, right? So, but I'm curious to know what your guys' strategy was behind your price point.
It's been an ongoing conversation up until like an hour ago, honestly, before our pre-sale, because, you know, NFTs have music NFTs, regular NFTs, they have an ebb and flow with the community based on what sentiment is. And there have been a couple drops on Record Shop that didn't sell out. So then it's like, all right, if the community feels tapped out because there have been a lot of drops, maybe we have to drop the mint count. So they're excited about, even though they're excited about ours, they might just be tapped out. Yeah. So those are things that like kind of get weighed. But also, you know, some of the stuff that fed into ours was that we've been with the platform since the beginning. We've done a ton of engagement. So where another artist, even if they were doing all the same things that we were, if they didn't have that kind of legacy status on the platform, they might not be able to mint as many. So these are like some of the things I had conversations around all week. And Becca from Record Shop's a fucking hero for dealing with me and like the million questions I had for her. But it all basically goes into like a really thorough Excel file and like play with mint counts, play with, all right, what's the utility on this card going to be if you burn it? So maybe depending what that utility is, we might want to make it more rare. So like play with those numbers and it all kind of works together and you eventually spit out the number you want. And then the price point is always tied to the coin counts. So the sound token, there's a sound token attached to each collectible and that correlates to whatever the final price is. They kind of work together with that. So yeah, it's pretty interesting and I'm glad I don't have to do that as my job because I'd lose my mind.
That's so cool. Like the concept of burning a token to then it's almost like an unlockable, it's like a key, right? Where like you burn it and then you receive the utility. Is that, am I understanding that right?
Yeah. And that's what we put a lot of that into our pack where there's ones that are multi-step. So like we'll have some collectibles in there where if you combine it with another one, it makes a new one that you couldn't have gotten in the pack. And then if you were to take a number of those and combine those together, you can do what's called mixing in Record Shop, where you take more than one collectible and you mix them together and then it puts out a new collectible. So we have ones where it involves like multiple layers of mixing to get to this end reward that people would be after that you couldn't get any other way, basically. So like you mentioned gamification before, like that's one of the unique things about this and just is fun as an artist, like trying to figure out things that would make fans of yours get excited to try to figure out like how they can, you know, whatever, unlock these different utilities. Some of them are in real life things. Some of them are just whatever, additional mixes, tracks. Yeah. Ed wants the ability to mute Nick on command.
So does my wife. How about that? She wants that NFT at all times.
So cool. Yeah.
But yeah, the mixing feature is awesome. So like we put a lot of thought into that stuff where it's like you're going to take two collectibles that really have nothing to do with each other. And when you put them together, you're going to get something dope out of it.
I should mention there's also like because people in the Record Shop community, we've been in touch with them and they were giving us ideas of like things we can do. And they were like, you know, you should also recognize the people that were supporters of your previous drops. So now there's things where if you mix a card from our new drop and you held one of the cards from our old drop, you could mix the old and the new to get something. So then that means if you didn't pick up the pack that we were in previously, now you go to the marketplace, try to find it so that you can mix those together. Smart. And come up with something new. So it really, because there's a core group on there that's very active, but the idea is we want to bring as many new people on as possible. So we wanted to kind of layer the challenges. So there were some that were accessible and then there were some that we know only a handful are going to try to go through the steps.
Yeah. Right. So the one of one is basically the person who buys the most packs straight up is getting a day with us, whether that's in the studio or just hanging out and going out to dinner. Like they're going to get a day to hang out with us. Sick. If you buy the most packs. And then the top 20 pack buyers. Well, let me back up. In December, I think it was December, right, Danny? We did the Participate to Create event. I don't know if we talked to you about that at all at any point, but anybody watching who wasn't familiar, we had 250 people qualify through certain collectible steps to co-produce a record with us. So we had a private Discord channel they were invited to. We went live. You could watch on Twitch, but you couldn't actually participate with feedback for what we would put into the record. But this private Discord channel, we would do questions like, do you like this vocal or that vocal? Do you like this synth or that synth? Should we move this part here? Should we add percussion hit there? So like all these people were able to contribute to it. And so we're doing that in a more limited scope for this pack, but just for 20 buyers. The top 20 buyers are going to get to do that with us on a new record. And so they'll be credited. And we have a bunch of projects coming out this year on our label, including an EP. So it could land anywhere. You know, it could land as a music NFT, or it might land on a real project. We don't know yet.
That's wild. So when you say your label, you mean like, do you guys have your own label or like Spinning or?
Yeah, we have a label called Liftoff that we've been releasing on now for, I want to say 10 years or so.
Coming up on it.
And we have about 150 releases on the label. And the main thing is like, we try to support a lot of the guys who come on the stream that are up and comers that make really dope shit. And then once in a while, we put out our own record. But this year, we just renewed our deal with our distributor. And as part of that, we were like, we're going to do a new indie EP where we can kind of run the whole thing and do it how we want. So
yeah. I love it. I mean, would love to chat further about onboarding your label to Bridge and getting things moving, because that's what it's about. And I love artist driven labels, because we get it. We've been through it. We understand kind of, you know, all the ups and downs, and like, and it's also about, you know, in so many kind of instances with dealing with the legacy music industry, you're dealing with an A&R that was never an artist. You're dealing with an A&R that, like, you know, it went to business school to learn how to do music business. Like, I don't know how to break it to you guys, but like, your course at Berkeley did not teach you what you need to know about dealing with an artist. You know what I mean? Like,
no,
it's true. Like so much like emotional kind of ups and downs that you go through as an artist. And like, you have to be very kind of like open and vulnerable and have like open conversations and like creative conversations. And I'm you know, huge fan of artists kind of leading their own labels. So mad respect for that.
Yeah, thank you, man. It's not for the faint of heart, that's for sure. Nope. And so we did everything in the beginning up until about a year and a half ago. We did all the marketing. We did all the accounting. We set up all the releases. We signed all the releases, negotiated the contracts, Danny did all the promo videos, the artwork, like literally just the two of us, in addition to all the other shit we do. And so it got to a point where we were like, we're going to fucking lose our minds. And,
well, and it was hurting the label, because we can't dedicate enough time to really make it
right
legit.
Yeah, so we brought on a label manager about a year and a half ago, and that's been going awesome. And we want to grow a lot more over the next year. So it's totally different. Like, if somebody wants to start their own label and they just want to like self-release on through TuneCore or whatever, so be it. Go have fun. Yeah. Like, that's awesome. But when
it's awesome that it's that easy.
Yeah, but when you really get into it and you like start signing people and trying to pitch for sync, which is a whole nother thing. You got to have strong teams that you at least work with that are third parties if you don't have your own internal team.
Yeah, and totally agree with that. And it's like, you know, I really realized that myself very quickly as well. And, you know, I'm still like, right now I literally have Word documents of like contracts that I have to go through and edit like as we speak. And it's a lot. Yeah, it's a lot. And the thing is like, as an artist, like, that is perhaps like an up and coming artist that like hasn't really gone through kind of what we've gone through, like they don't know like all the details that goes into like running a label. And it's tricky sometimes, because you have to kind of be like, hey, like, you know, like, this is the budget for this release for this reason. Yeah. And like, this is like, you know, like, you know, and it's those, you have to have those hard conversations sometimes. Right. But it's important. I think that, like, you know, the independent music industry needs to start really leaning into music NFTs and you know, finding ways to kind of, you know, incorporate like the emerging artists that they have on the roster to really like champion this, because it's like, you know, the artists that are, you know, already stuck in kind of major label deals, like, they're it's going to be a lot more challenging for them to kind of adopt and champion music NFTs just because they are at the mercy of you know, their labels. But like the independent space is exciting, man. And like conversations we're having with Believe and Create, like they're all very excited about music NFTs. Like Create, I don't know if you guys saw, but a friend of mine, Andre from Trap Nation, Andre Benz, who he basically sold half of Trap Nation to Create now, and they're opening up a Web3 venture together between Create and Andre. And it's yeah, and it's like these, you know, these kinds of partnerships and like this innovation, like this is what's going to drive the space forward, and that's going to come from the independent like level, you know. So yeah, all that to say.
The other thing I love is just that this is going to up the bar when you do go to a bigger label, what you expect of them and what they can do for you. Because I feel like a lot of times, like we'll sign a record to a label because we can get certain DJ looks, or we can get whatever it might be. That label has a strength in some area that we want to tap into. But when you tap into Web3 and you're able to like own your masters and generate real revenue, now like you're not just going to a label for like DJ looks. Like you want to know that they can move the needle in other ways and that it's sustainable for you as an artist. So I love when things just like up the bar on like what we expect of, you know, a partner that we're potentially signing over a record, 50 to 60% of a record to, you know, what are you going to do to return essentially our investment on that 50 to 60%? So that's cool.
Facts. 50 to 60% is generous for a lot of cases.
Yeah. Not majors.
That's not the first deal you're going to sign.
Cam said small shitty labels be like, we own 50% forever and we're dedicated. $16 for promo marketing. We won't be sending this to any DJs. This is also true.
They can't afford it on the MailChimp
To
send it out to DJs. So
Affiliate said, it sounds like a ton of artists are just stuck. Yes, agreed. Web3 is providing them a whole new breath of fresh air. Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing is like, because it's new tech, because everybody's psyched about what can happen in the space, there, even if you don't make tons of money in it, it's inspiring to be around people are inspired in the space. And that alone is worth putting in your time for.
Yeah,
for sure. And there's going to be money to be made, like, you know, and the builders in the space that are, you know, that are in it right now, just exactly like with Spotify, right? Like if you were on Spotify from like back 2013, 2014, like it came to Canada, I think in 2014. And like, I was like, yo, what is this? Like, I need to find a way to get on. And then, you know, started releasing some music independently. And like, whenever you're ahead of the curve, you're always in an advantage. Always, always, always. And like the only reason why I was able to actually like live off of music and be able to get a record deal with Sony, et cetera, was because, like, shout out to Austin Kramer, was because I got into some playlists. I was relevant, right? And it's just about dipping your toes into like new innovative kind of platforms and technologies, and you know, the rest kind of usually happens seamlessly, right?
So I'm 12 coffees in. I need to take a brief moment, and I'm gonna throw you into one of our segments with Danny here. So this one is called, what do you want to give him? Music Dropout?
Oh yeah, sure.
Yeah, because you had a prior career, so this would be interesting to go into. This segment is called Music Dropout.
All right, so the premise of this is you get 100% fed up with the music industry. You want nothing to do with it, but you need to make money somehow. We already know the like renewable energy space is not your calling. So what would you do if you just didn't have it in you to do music anymore?
Wow. Putting me on the spot, man. I think it would just still kind of be in the entrepreneurial world. You know, maybe like in just technology in general, would love to kind of, yeah, like just investing, you know, maybe some stuff on the venture capital side. Like, but yeah, I mean, I'm also like, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think there is a lot of crossover there, obviously. And like, I mean, plenty of people do dabble in both. What if money wasn't an object? What would you do? Wow. If you just like didn't have to worry about money, what would you do to fill your time?
be chilling on a beach, you know, just, no, I think like it's wild to think like of a world without music, right? Like as artists and as musicians, because it just kind of consumes you and you know, it is your passion. But I mean, maybe like my dad's a chef, like maybe I'd get into like, you know, cooking, or maybe I'd, okay. You know, yeah, like I also like love sports. Like I played college basketball, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe I would coach kids, like coach a college basketball team or something like that.
And I feel like all that still has like a creative element to it, whether like as a chef, you're going to be coming up with, you know, like new ideas, whatever. But honestly, even I found like teaching and coaching requires a lot of creativity, because it's all about like presenting information in different ways to try to connect with someone, which sometimes can be really, really difficult. So clearly something that has you like your creative brain working.
For sure. For sure. What about you guys? I'm curious. You guys probably have answered this question a million times, but like,
I didn't hear the context of the question.
Have we answered this one?
What was the question?
Music dropout. I flipped it and said like, if money wasn't an object, you didn't have to like work, what would you fill your time with?
I don't know that I've been thinking about this more and more, because I don't know that I would do that much different than what I'm doing. I definitely would like buy a farm in Tuscany and spend like half of my week just planting seeds and walking around and doing nothing.
Hands behind your back.
Just, yeah, 100%. I don't want a farm. Like, I don't want to deal with milking any goats or anything like that, but I'll make some fucking cheese. I'll do that for half of my time. But as far as the music stuff, I'd want to pursue everything I'm doing now. Like I wouldn't do that much different, you know?
Yeah. I feel like I would still be creating stuff in like a digital space. It would just be a lot less productive, because I wouldn't have like any deadlines or like, goals. It would just be experimentation and like, messing around, which it is super fulfilling, but not doesn't pay the bills always.
Yeah, facts.
Most uninteresting answers.
Yeah. Well, no, because like the more I get into, you know, we picked up like motion, which is like After Effects, like animated visuals, and then getting into video editing, and then there's the whole world of like 3D modeling, that kind of stuff. And like, I haven't even dipped my toes in that, because I know if I like just started to mess with it, I would it's so difficult when it's like a tab away that you're like, oh, I could like finish this thing I'm supposed to, or I could just like see what's up over here. Because like, I don't know. It's so exciting, like how easy it is to learn stuff now. Mm-hmm. There's resources available for literally anything you want to learn. And, I find it hard not to like to be disciplined in like finishing what needs to be done, because just like with music, I always just want to start another thing, learn another thing, like new, exciting, constantly.
I think it's, if money was an object, you'd be 3D modeling. I literally just got done like looking up how to properly string up a vineyard in my backyard. That was like my choice of the tab to go to. And you're,
see,
like,
I 3D print a gondola for you, and then you just
I love it.
So we'd still be working as a team and basically still in the same capacity, but
I love it. Yeah. I mean, what's interesting too is like when thinking about that, I'm always leaning towards, I want to be able to disconnect more.
Mm.
Because a lot of what happens on this is just fucking noise. And it's checking the same shit often for the dopamine drip to figure out like, all right, did something happen that's exciting? And when you get those drips, you're like, oh, see, it justifies me checking this more often. You know what I mean? Like, you're always going back for more.
It's a drug.
Yeah. Damon Sharp, when are we launching Disco Wines? As soon as we launch Disco Vines, okay? We need the vines before the wines. shout out to Rim This Music in the chat, a regular here and on Dope or Nope. Oh, also, I should mention we are doing Dope or Nope at 3, but it's going to be a separate stream. So we'll close this stream and then we'll open that one because that's on Reach now. So reach.me.
Dope. Nice.
So let's talk about the music, man. I mean, I don't know how much you could talk about upcoming stuff.
What you've got coming up, what you're excited about.
I'm an open book. Yeah. So I have I'm like mainly just writing for other producers, DJs and stuff like that right now. Like obviously with the label and with like the music NFT, you know, startups, it's challenging to balance everything, as I'm sure you guys are aware, but, have a cut with Regard coming out, in the summer,
big one, pretty huge. Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. And a couple other kind of, fun collaborations that are in the works. But like definitely trying to like right now, my goal is to really foster the talent that we have at Sadboy Records to get them to dip their toes in the music NFT space, like start like really getting them to like actually just buy into it and then like, start seeing some real money and generating some revenue. And like, it's challenging for me as like a label owner. And I'm sure you guys know that the grind too, to like issue like $200 statements every 6 months. It's like, man, like, I feel like it's a grind. And then I want to kind of like really get our artists like excited about music again. And about like, how like your music actually has value. And like, so yeah, my goal is really just like, we're signing a lot of new music right now. We're working with like some really sick, like innovative artists. I'd say that, more so for me personally, like that's what I'm really excited about. But like on the side, like, I'd love to kind of like, work with you guys perhaps one day and like, send over some vocals and see what we can do. And
please,
for sure. Like that's the vibe. Like, I'm realizing music is definitely like more of a hobby, kind of like secondary thing than it is. Like for me personally as a creative. And I think that's one of the reasons why I wasn't ready for like the major label thing, just because it I don't live and breathe in that like artist vein. I'm more of like a business minded person with other things kind of going. So love making music, love songwriting, like definitely just song, also writing for other artists. So this really sick talented artist by the name of Amanda Francis. You guys should check her out. She's also in the Web3 space. We just wrote a really sick song a few months back called Making Out with Vampires. It's out today. She's also
nice. Oh, dope.
We gotta pull that out.
Yeah. Check her out. But yeah, just working with like passion projects that I'm excited about. And but I'm curious, what about you yourselves? I know you guys probably have like a full release schedule organized. You guys are like, super with it. I'm curious what's next for you guys.
This is it, right?
Hey, yep. Thank you.
Amanda Francis, Making Out with Vampires. Go add it to your playlist. So you are a co-writer on this?
Correct. And vocal producer.
Nice. Dope. It's awesome.
Nice. Cheers. Yeah. A vibe,
Yeah, for sure. So what was your question to us exactly?
What's your guys' kind of schedule looking like the next little while, in terms of like music and creatively, like where are you guys at? Creatively, like what's kind of getting, what are you guys working on in the studio? What you guys got cooking? I'm curious.
Yeah, so we got a bunch of remixes kind of coming up as far as like immediate releases. Remixes, and then we have a new single coming out May 20th on Spinning with Harbor and Lux Tides.
Sick.
Lux Tides did the record Hero with Afrojack. And
yes,
Harbor,
she's great.
Sick. She's awesome.
Yep.
And Harbor we've worked with on a bunch of records kind of behind the scenes, and now finally got to do a proper co-build collab together. So that's coming out there. And then, like I said earlier, we're doing the EP on our label, which will probably like start dripping out singles from sometime in the summer, and then work towards that. And then we're doing a project on Arpeggi. I don't know if you're familiar with Arpeggi, but
we're
doing a project with them and super excited about that.
Yeah.
So that's going to be the first EP on their platform.
Wow.
That we're doing in partnership with them. So huge. Psyched to try that out.
Cause it's like a DAW, right? It's like literally a Web3 DAW. Unreal.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's really,
and they're adding functionality all the time. I'm really curious to see like kind of where they get it to, but just the concept and like getting that infrastructure down is the key to make it as successful. But it's such a dope idea. For anyone that isn't familiar with it, Nick should just give like a little rundown. But the way I would describe it, like A-SHO said, DAW on the blockchain, and basically has like a sample marketplace built into it, similar to like Splice or something like that. But then it's giving credit back to the creators of those samples as they're being used in projects. Like, I can't even imagine how you would account for that any other way.
Yeah, in a Web2 situation.
On like, yeah.
Not well. Yeah, it's pretty awesome. So it's got the social component too, because they have a really strong community. So the Discord is always popping. People always have new ideas because it's mostly, there's a ton of producers in there. There's obviously just music fans, but there's a ton of producers who have great ideas for the platform. So when we started exploring it, I mean, it was really behind where they are now. And I know where they're going is going to be even more insane. So some of the production we're going to have to do in like a Logic or Ableton, and then export some loops and things like that. But what also is cool is like that whole sample bank that's connected to the platform is just part of it. It's not like you're paying extra for that. And everything's Creative Commons. So when we create a sample, that automatically goes into that sample bank. And then you could create a new track or a remix of it, whatever, and you could use our sample in your track. But either way, we're getting a micro payment when you sell yours from the usage of that. So the more of our stuff that gets used, the better. So it incentivizes people to create a ton of new shit to just go out there with. And then, you know, I've been talking to them about people who don't necessarily want to create records, but want to create stuff for the sample bank for use. And that's going to be a scenario. But I think the most valuable part of the whole thing is that they own the IP on all this. So to integrate that into an Ableton or a Logic. Oh,
dude, yeah. The first DAW that integrates something like that is going to be so, so mind blowing.
Yeah. So needless to say, we invested in that. And there's that too.
So, and that's ARPEG, which is ARPEGGI.io. And I think you can join like the beta to check it out. They have like a functioning thing up that you can kind of mess around with. But like I said, early days, but the concept is like mind blowing.
Yeah, unreal. It's and those guys are super genuine people too, and like just very innovative. Like just hearing them talk in Twitter Spaces, they're just trying to build cool shit, you know. And it's like, you're not only are you building cool shit, like you're completely disrupting the music industry, and it's super innovative. And I like the concept of, you know, doing your sound design, doing like your, you know, building your kind of sauce, you know, on Ableton, and then, you know, importing that one new sample as one WAV file essentially on ARPEGGI. Now anybody else could use it. Like so cool, crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's insane.
Oh man, when that gets me thinking, Nick, like when are they going to have like a plugin format that's on the blockchain, like VST, but the blockchain equivalent? Like,
yeah, I mean, maybe that's something to talk to ARPEGGI about, that because they have a mint functionality where you basically, when you create your track, you can, instead of just bouncing it, you can mint it straight to OpenSea. And so I wonder if they could just break that mint button, like that mint technology out as a standalone.
Oh, yeah. I wasn't even like how you used to, can you still do that in Ableton? Like upload directly to SoundCloud? I know that was a thing at some point. You used to be able to, and you might still be able to. I just never have done it. There's some kind of functionality where you put in your login credentials and it'll put it straight up on SoundCloud for you. So yeah, same kind of thing, except that it goes through Bridge and then it goes.
Hey, there you go.
Yeah. So Urban Owl said they already do have a VST on the blockchain. Hang on. With a key system. Can you describe what this key utility function is? Sorry, I'm just putting out a fire. Hang on.
Oh, yeah.
No, it's all
like, tell us what, what to look up to find what that's called. Because I'm curious what that even, like, what the function of it is exactly. But that, yo, that's what's so exciting. It's just like, I feel like every time we have a conversation with someone about this space, there's at least like one little takeaway where I'm like, wow, I never thought of that before. And even if it's not something someone explicitly said, it gets you thinking about like possibilities of things that you could start working on, or things that you know are coming down the pipeline that you can start figuring out how you can angle to implement stuff like that. There's just so many, there's literally like endless directions to go.
For sure. It's crazy because it's like, you know, in so many of these conversations that, you know, we have, I think in the Web3 space, there's so many of these ideas that it's like, I almost want to like protect kind of like our IP on some of them, because it's like the first person that actually does it will like, it'll be fire.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Yeah. Like that's how early we are right now, right? It's exciting. Right. Yeah.
It is super exciting. So on that note, other exciting things are the topics that we drop on the show, such as this next one, which is called Nightmare Story.
I love it.
Now, I'm just going to give myself props for that segue because it was pretty good.
Oh, yeah, it's smooth. Those, butter.
Those graphics, like in between, those things. Dope. I'm like, I get so hyped and excited. I'm like, let's go.
Yeah, I got to fit. We're going to probably move to a new platform called Reach.me soon, which is where Dope or Nope is right now. And it's a little bit more tricky to do some of those. I got to work that out with their team and figure out how to keep them.
For anyone that copies and pastes that, it's just images of keys. So actually, no, that doesn't even explain it. It just explains what it looks like.
Well done, though. That's awesome. So music industry or Web3 or a little of both, Nightmare Story. And you can reserve names and platforms if you need to.
Oh, man. I got so many. let me try to find one that's like kind of like funnier than like just, yeah, just bad. Wow. Web3 Nightmare Story. Man, that's a good question. Like, I mean, you hear a bunch of just like, yeah, just like lots of rug pulls in the space. But like for me personally, it's just like challenging in general. Like when you're, I wouldn't call it a nightmare story. It's just like the startup life, you know, like when you're trying to make something from scratch and you're starting a new company and you're hiring developers. Like, man, a lot of these developers, like they're very well aware that they're in high demand, especially blockchain developers, and they're going to screw you over.
Oh, yeah, sure.
And you know, I've been, I've dished out a lot of money now from myself, from the label that like, you know, went to some of these developers that just ran away and provided us like copy paste, you know, whack smart contracts, like code that don't even actually do anything. Right. So, I'd say like Web3, it's been a grind to like really kind of like, find the right team and build something like that, you know, is sustainable. And now, you know, we're very excited about where we are now. We actually have the head of product at SoCan, which is like a performing rights organization in Canada. Yeah. They have rights to like Drake, The Weeknd, you know, Justin Bieber, et cetera. So he's, you know, he's part of the team now and working with us direct. So like,
that's awesome.
We're kind of like, you know, finding those key players that are like of people that are like, you know, music enthusiasts and as well that have like a development or Web3 background that are, you know, excited about what we're doing. So like, we know they're not going to rug us. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But yeah, in terms of just like web, yeah, like Web2, like, you know, legacy music industry, like just like random, like releasing music. So I don't know how much you guys have dealt with this, but like when you kind of like invest in an artist and like, you know, you bring them on your label and like you invest time, resources, you know, A&Ring like their records and like, you know, putting them in touch with the right people. And, you know, you really like put a lot of time and effort into it. And then, you know, artists that come with just like crazy demands or like the, you know, a song doesn't hit like a million streams and like, they're like, yo, take it down. Like I'm out, you know? And like, I think like it's wild. Yeah. And it's wild. And then like, you know, one artist like went as far as like issuing a takedown through Spotify and Apple Music. So like, it's like an official kind of like I don't know, copyright infringement thing, and then boom, like
strike on the label. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And then boom, like that, those, like all those streams are gone. Like, you, like the song gets taken down. It's like, it's just nightmare, right? Like that, the classic kind of, you know, scenario where it's like, you know, you as a label, and it's funny because like, labels have a, such a bad rap in like the grand scheme of things for like a lot of yeah. I don't know, industry talk. But in the end, it's like independent labels are like, we're like championing you guys as artists. Like we're out here, like literally doing what we can just because we believe in you. Like, I, like Sad Boy Records is like borderline not-for-profit record label. Right. So I'm like investing time and resources just like, cause I believe in you. Right. And then it's like, boom, you just get hit with these like crazy demands. And yeah, it's a grind. The music industry, like as it stands currently, you know, there's just not very much money flowing around. And it's like, you know, you got to be very careful with which opportunities you take. And like, that's, you know, that's why I'm so heavily invested into like Web3 music and NFTs, because it's like, hey, like, you know, you're not happy with like how the song is doing on streaming. Great. Well, I just made you 10 grand from releasing your music NFT. Right. It's like, we're all happy. Yeah. We're all good, you know? So it's yeah. Anyways, I don't know. Well, I'm curious. What about you guys?
No, I'd be curious. How did an artist like want to pull a record?
Oh man.
I had artists that have been like, I changed my brand entirely. Yeah. And like, this doesn't align with it. Would you pull it down? And then we said no, because we own it and go fuck yourself.
Have we done that on like, it was like an artist that just did something on a compilation. I feel like we,
yeah,
like figured out at least so it didn't show up in their like,
we had to hide it
on their page, like yeah. How to hide it. Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
But like some asks are just a little ridiculous to your point. Like these are things you should think of before you put the record out. And like,
and a record, yeah, like sign a contract. Yeah.
Yeah. Like there's that. There's also like people's brands change. Of course, we're not making the same music we made 10, 12 years ago. And there's plenty of releases if you dig through our catalog, including a record with the situation from Jersey Shore that we did.
Said
who the fuck gives a shit about that now? Like, you know, it's not, but if somebody went and looked up Disco Fries, it's part of our story. It's part of like one right. of the things, random things we're connected to in the past decade or so, you know?
Love it. I love it. Is it like Mike, like the dude, Mike, the situation?
Yeah. So anyway, he was friends with a bunch of mutual friends that I have in New Jersey and came to my house. This was prior to him being sober. And, it was interesting to say the least, but we did it with DJ Class, who had a big record. How long ago did Class's record come out? The big single he did.
That would have been like 2009, 2008 to 2010, somewhere in there.
Yeah. So he had a record called I'm the Shit, which Kanye did a remix of.
Mm-hmm.
And that blew up as a single. He put it out independently and then it got licensed up to Universal. Kanye jumped on it, whatever. So
wow.
We were cool with him and Fat Man Scoop, who we had worked on with a bunch of records. And somehow us, Fat Man Scoop and Class did a record with Mike the Situation. And it is bizarre.
I love it.
But anyway, it's part of the story. It's, I love it's part it. Of the lineage.
That's so dope. Yeah. It's cool how Fat Man Scoop really like digs the EDM stuff. Eh? He just like goes ham like that. Like those hype vocals just get you like, especially at a festival. I love that. Like you just get so like turned up. Like it's dope. Yeah.
Yeah. He's the voice of the club. He's insane. I actually just talked to him this morning, and he was getting off a flight from like Dubai or some shit. And so he's still like crazy active touring.
Yeah, he travels. Yeah.
I don't know that it's got. He's got some crazy news coming out of an album that he's part of that's probably going to be one of the biggest albums of 2022.
Sick.
And I can't say who it is because I don't think he talked about it yet, so I'll just keep my mouth shut on that.
Dope.
But the fact that he's been doing it as long as he has and then to get that look at this point in his career is insane.
Right, for sure. Very impressive. Yeah, he's an OG. Is he like also a DJ, like full-on DJ producer as well?
Not producer.
Okay. Mm-mm. But he does like, obviously he's like hype man, you know, DJ. I'm curious, he's kind of like a DJ Khaled in the sense, and like, you know, where he puts pieces of the puzzle together and
to a degree, he's more just, he can DJ for sure, but like he'll do a bunch of the Knicks games where he'll DJ and he'll hype up the crowd and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Definitely more of an MC than anything else.
Yeah.
Right.
Makes sense.
Yeah. So,
And he just has, I don't know, he just has a presence. Like, even when he's not performing, he's just like an entertaining person. There's like no way to be around him and not to be like entertained. Even if he's not trying to do anything entertaining, he just is.
Danny and I were like going to his house. Every session with him is like 15 hours when really the session needs to be 10 minutes. But like Danny and I were going to his house years ago, and it was one of those days where it was going to be like, we're doing a full day with Scoop, but we'll probably record for 45 minutes. And he's like, I got to go buy a freezer. And like, we just went with him to like buy a meat freezer.
Yeah, he was like, meet us at the Home Depot in wherever, upstate New Jersey. It'll just take a sec. And then like, we're in a four-way conversation with him and the Home Depot employee about like what like chest freezer is going to be best for the size of his family.
Bizarre shit, but very entertaining.
Well, it's interesting because it's like, if you really think about it, like the whole music industry is just about relationships, and it's about having like moments like that, just authentic kind of chill moments like that with like, you know, people that you kind of relate to. It's like 99% of it is just about who you know and how you present yourself. And then the 1% is about, you know, like I just made a tweet about this the other day, and Nick, you commented on it. It's like the music has to be good, but like in the end, you can make the dopest music. And, you know, if you don't know anybody and you're not networking, and, you know, your music is going to stay on the hard drive, or it's going to have, you know, one less than 1,000 streams on Spotify. So it's interesting.
Yeah, no, that's such a great point. And anybody who's not following A-SHO on Twitter, this guy is dropping tons of game, so I highly recommend it.
I talk my shit on Twitter. I just rediscovered Twitter, you know, this year. It's good for like the whole music NFT space like lives on Twitter, it feels like. Mm-hmm. So
it's interesting how it really did, like, at least for our community, it seems like that really revitalized Twitter, because as a platform, I feel like everyone was moving to Instagram. But now I mean, there's a lot going on Twitter, which was not the case 2 years ago.
For sure.
Yeah, I noticed, especially when I started doing more of the Web3 spaces and music NFT chats and stuff like that. Yo, it's crazy what kind of growth you see from that stuff. Just getting involved and jumping in. And like the people that are in those spaces. I was in one with Rain Maida from Our Lady Peace, Wes Borland, and then like a bunch of other crazy people that I'm like, I fucking listen to these guys like growing up, and now they're doing music NFTs, and I'm having a conversation with them, and it's really just fucking weird and awesome. But those things happen like every other day now. So, and any artist in the space that might be watching, I would encourage you to jump in those spaces. And even if you don't know anything, just jump up, ask a question, or just listen in and start participating.
Just listen,
For sure. Shout out to you, Urban Owl. That's so sick, man. I'm about to find you on Instagram and Twitter and give you a follow, man. That's so cool. It's so weird for me because like I'm not like a big artist. Like I'm just like some nobody that kind of just like released some music on Spotify and then like, you know, did some little things here and there. So like to actually hear that there's like people that like have heard my music is wild to me, you know? So much love to you guys, to you, Urban Owl. That's awesome.
How do you typically work like on the songwriting side? Are you doing songs on your own and then sending those demos out and acapellas out, or do you prefer to write to a track the traditional way?
So I mean, these days, obviously, like since COVID, it's been very much just like me working kind of alone, like, or I'll get like a demo or an idea from a producer like yourselves, for example, and you know, we'll build out a vocal from that, and like I'll do all my, you know, vocal editing, processing, etc., and send you like a finished product basically, and then, you know, for the producers to kind of build on top of. But like with like what I also definitely enjoy is like is writing, you know, in the room together with, you know, another artist or another producer. And I feel like you know, a lot of the magic can happen just when you're together in a room. But like, yeah, like, you know, I'm happy to work either way. And as long as like, you know, the vibe is good and this, you know, whatever the demo is inspiring, then, you know, that's, you know, one thing leads to another. But yeah, what about you guys? I'm curious, what do you prefer, in the room or just kind of in your own little bubble?
It's interesting. Like Nick and I have gotten used to, and we've talked about this before, like, our workflow, since we are hours apart and have been for a while, we're used to this like kind of remote workflow where like we can each, there's certain parts of the creative process that work very well to be fast, bounce ideas off of each other. And then there's like the finer details where you might be sitting there for a few hours on like an 8-bar section. So it helps to have that time alone to do that stuff. But it is, there's something about being in the room with other people. The last time that Nick came to my place, I want to say it was like February 2020, right before like everything shut down. And like in 2 days, I want to say we got to like the 60 or 70% mark on like 5 or 6 records that we then like, he went back home and then it was like, all right, the next few weeks, we're just going to like finish out these ideas. Whereas if we tried to like, if we set a deadline and we were like, all right, in a month, we're going to have 6 finished records, it would be very difficult to do. Cause like, there's no, even if it's just me on the computer for the whole time, Nick being there, I work very differently because I don't want him to get bored of what I'm doing. I want to keep him engaged, and vice versa. If Nick's on, like, you just move through the process faster. You're not worried about the details.
Yeah, like I would play his piano parts and Daniel would be like, just fix it. He's like, he is anal about MIDI. And so if for him to be like, nah, I'll deal with it later, is way better for our workflow. But that's just like one of a million things that, whatever, play the part in, dope, sounds great, keep it moving. And then I can quantize this later and make it sound the way it's supposed to sound. But, and then the other thing is, because I'd only go down for like, we get together for a day or two, just time is finite. So we know we want to work through X amount of things. We get through X amount of things. And we set arbitrary timers too, where it's like, yo, I got to leave in like 2 hours.
Yeah, exactly. Yo, actually, I hadn't thought about it, but like Heartless was one of the records that we worked on that time that you were down, February 2020. And it didn't end up coming out until, when was that released?
Sometime in 2021. Mid-fall? Maybe a little earlier.
Yeah.
But either way, it took a long time.
Yeah.
Year and a half.
And same thing with working with other writers and stuff. I feel like there is something different to being there in person. Even we've done like, we'll do stuff over, we've used this platform, StreamYard, before to do like collaborative kind of stuff, which is cool too. But there's something different about working with people in a room. You end up like, you sit around, you bullshit for 3 hours, 4 hours, you grab food beforehand, something.
Yeah.
All kind of like feeds into that creative process that yields a different result.
Exactly. Just like build that like authentic kind of like relationship, friendship, that then you can come back in the room and like open up even more and get into like more details of like, you know, what you're writing about. And but I think that like you guys bring up an interesting point, because I think it's like any good song really like that does well like 99% of the time is like a good song like at the core, right? Like you can just like sing it and play piano or play guitar with it, and like, and it should feel, make you feel something, right? So I think it's like we sometimes we overcomplicate things. I think it's like producers, like, you know, and artists in general, where we're like, you know, we try to add too much too quickly. But in the end, it's like, you know, if the song is not good, then like, I don't know, it probably won't work, right? But however, you know, having said that, dance music is a little different, because, you know, it's sometimes it's just for a club, right? And sometimes like there's very little vocals, and sometimes it's just like a catchy, you know, little phrase that like you put on repeat or you pitch down, and then like that inspires kind of the rest of it. So you know, I think you know, for me personally, like as a songwriter, like I like kind of creating a song, you know, at least like a you know, a verse, a hook, you know, a pre-hook, maybe whatever, like a B hook. Just to kind of have like that first half of this, of the, like the vocal done. And then like, that's what I'll send to, you know, a different producer, et cetera, to kind of build on top of it. But
that's dope. So you want to send over a folder of those? Can we get a folder of those things?
Dude, I got you. Let me open up the vault and see what's still good. Like I haven't even like, I very, very rarely do I actually just like make music on my off time now. It's like, I'm just, you know, grinding this, like this startup life. But yeah, like we'll definitely send over some stuff ASAP.
Awesome. Nice. Danny, what were you saying?
Oh, I was going to say, like, do you find you'll then, like, say you write verse, pre-chorus and chorus and send it off to a producer. Do you find yourself going back and adding another verse or a bridge, like that kind of stuff after you've sort of heard what the producer does around your song?
It's funny that you say that, because like anytime that I do that, the producer's like, no, like it was good, like don't change it. Like don't change anything. But like, yeah, of course, like whether it's like layering vocals or adding ad libs or, you know, kind of spicing things up a little to make it sound fuller, or like maybe making a vocal chop with like, you know, Melodyne or whatever. Yeah. Like I love that shit, you know, like that's like I think that, you know, using like your voice as an instrument is like super dope to me. And whereas, you know, I think it's like, it could kind of get a little cheesy sometimes where like, you're just kind of like a song is just singing and it's just, there's no kind of like interesting, I don't know, like weird, unique sounds that are happening and stuff. So like, I love like kind of innovating and doing some weird shit with that for sure.
That's a really good point. We do listen to demos on the show a lot. We actually didn't have anybody drop links today. Maybe because we haven't done
Dave,
demos anymore.
Radio Dave did like at the very top.
Oh, we should pull that up. Can you just text that to me if you find it?
Yeah, if you check, I think I sent it to your WhatsApp.
Oh, you did? I see it. Yeah. Okay, anyway, we'll listen to that one in a minute. But a lot of the stuff that comes through, of course, it's a dead link, Dave. Can't find that page on SoundCloud. That's not good. Oh wait,
Dave sent a new one for Finish My Track that was dope. And I'm pretty sure he's already got like interest from a label on it. He's doing good work.
Drop your song, Urban Al. I'm curious. And shout out to Noah, MTL represent, MTL Montreal. That's where I'm from. And it sounds like there's a whole crew. Shout out to Kasnowski. That's insane. I think what it is that there was this artist. I don't know if you guys have heard of him. His name is Kaleox. He was popping in the deep house scene like way back in 2015. Yeah. But like you guys actually have a very similar sound. So it sounds like, you know, some of your kind of fans or producer homies have cross-pollinated, which is dope.
That is awesome. It's such a small business. Dave, I got it. You're good. You're good. I just hit you back. Cam sent one too. So I'm going
to. Nice. Yeah. We haven't heard one from Cam in a minute.
Can you snag that one? I forget how do this in StreamYard where they don't let you copy and paste. You got to.
I know. Only if you're a guest and since I'm like not logged into our.
Yeah, that's bizarre.
Our account. And then, all right. So that was Cam's. Here's
One of the benefits of being live right now is all the madness and Discord around the pack and questions I can't address until after the stream. So that'll be fun to do. Yeah, guys, by the way, quick plug. I'm just going to play this video again. The live, God damn it. That was not a good segue. the pre-sale's now up on Record Shop for our Friends of Fries pack. Go check it out. It drops next week, but you can buy it early now. And for buying it early, you don't get everything in the pack until next week, but you do get a free collectible. And everybody in the pre-sale is also going to get an airdrop at some point. So jump in. And yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
There it is. Thank you so much. We got you. Got you. All right. So let me play this Dave record. But what the point I was trying to make earlier, A-SHO, was that a lot of the records we get are super dope, but sometimes they're a little generic and literally need one piece of special sauce to change that. Like it could be a piano house record and it's a great song and it's a great piano house record, but it's like, what is going to be the differentiator between that and the MK record you're up against? Are you going to do something different? Are you going to make it sound like everything else? And if you're going to make it sound like everything else, then it's probably going to get lost in the sea of everything else. So to your point. Anyway, Dave does not make MK-style house music. In fact,
does not.
it's much different.
Oh, heads up. Before you play his Dave, that track in the teaser is one of the songs that'll be in the pack. But everyone should go grab that mini mix because there's a track that you might recognize right in the middle that you would have heard on this stream that is not released yet is hidden in that mini mix. So I just wanted to point that out.
All right. Can you guys hear this? I'll turn it up, obviously.
Yeah.
Hold on.
I got two thoughts. You can give him some feedback
in the meantime. Why not?
So one, I feel like that sound is really cool, and it's almost like a little too chaotic leading into it that you don't appreciate how cool it sounds because it's kind of like there's a lot going on, and then that sound is there. Whereas if you gave it like a little bit of a setup that wasn't as chaotic, and then that really struck you as something different, I think that would be kind of cool. I also just cool. want to this hear is that more like.
The mix isn't there, but like the idea of it being more dialed back.
Yeah. And even roll off some of those synths.
I think it's that grindy, active, grindy synth that takes away from the drop.
Right, because it hits like a similar sort of frequency range.
It's going to jump ahead.
There's a flavor. I have the first drop
to this. Oh, that's dope. I like this
one.
Yeah, that's sick. I also was waiting for a moment in the first drop. I don't know if it does it in this drop, where it just had like a break with a and it like reset for a second. It's so relentless that you never get a you never get a chance to breathe. So
yeah, it needs that like that low like the and then it needs to just like pitch bend down. It'll get so like grindy and weird. Like
yeah,
but yeah. That was the thought I had, but Nick articulated it better. That it's like figure out a way to have that sound, but like give it a second to breathe. Because all those times that you kind of like back off for a second is going to make it that much cooler and feel that much better when it's full on.
Nice work, Dave. You dropped a bunch of stuff in here, right?
Yeah, there was also one from Cam. Is that second link? And then there's an Urban Owl one. And who else did I grab it from?
Oh, I guess A-SHO, what was your feedback on Dave's record?
Dude, that shit bump. That shit bump. My favorite thing ever is hearing producers try to like explain what the sound is, just like using their voice. I love it. But yeah, dude, that's fire to me, man. Yeah, I'm like so. Yeah, just like FYI, I'm not a technical like sound designy producer. I'm more just like a vocal producer, and I let you know this. The smart folks like you guys to do all the hard stuff.
No, so. But honestly, like I feel like the perspective of someone that's not thinking about the technical stuff is usually even more valuable because that's the way most people are thinking about it.
Let's jump into Cam's. It's called Collapse. I'm just gonna jump ahead through the mix in. Thank you.
So I can't judge the mix at all. Like, it sounds like it's being played through a phone on my end. The energy is sick. I feel like in the second eight of the drop, when that like main synth goes up an octave, I feel like that's almost pulling the trigger too early. Like, you added some other sound in there with it. I feel like you could have kind of like let it ride. It feels really good. And I'm sure you've referenced other songs like this, the like future rave kind of stuff, to like figure out arrangement wise what works. But
I want to hear this next. Cam, I'm going to link you with, here's another good segue, guys. There's a guy called 10 Steps that's in our new Friends of Fries pack that you can grab right now on Record Shop. It's up for pre-sale. And Cam, I'm going to link you with 10 Steps because he might be all over this to work on together. And if nothing else, he's a great resource for you. If he's not into a collab or can't do it right now. So I will link you.
But yeah, that's, like I said, I can't hear the mix at all, but track sounds cool. I like that.
I like the energy. I felt like there's some emotion into it. Like, it felt kind of like, give me that epic feel. I was digging it.
Yeah, nice work, man. That was great. I'm putting together your email right now. That's how quick we do it here.
And A-SHO, what's up with this, the track with Hoover? What's up with that?
Yeah, just I figured we might as well get your guys' feedback on one of our new Sad Boy records. Have you guys heard of Hoover? Super talented Italian trap like producer. I mean, he does everything in the electronic space. But we're gonna work with him for an album. And he's this song is just fire. I love it. So I'm curious to hear you guys' feedback. Sick.
So Nick, the second,
the got this too. You guys are both in Vegas.
It's H-O. The other Urban L one, he says, is coming out on G Mafia in May. So let's check what that's about.
Okay, cool. So,
you're also in Vegas, right?
All right. Let me see. Wait, there's one other one here. Wings by Urban Owl. That's the one.
Yeah.
Gonna jump in a little.
solid groove.
Yeah, I feel like the sound design, all the sounds are there. And the groove is awesome. What I would say is that arpeggiated synth continue. I mean, I jumped through a little bit, but the arpeggiated synth continues through a big part of the track, and it could use a breather just so you miss it.
Yo, that was fire. That gave me that was Urban Owl, by the way, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he'll know what this means. And the other Montreal homies in the build, that gave me Picnic Electronic vibes. We have this incredible like summer, basically electronic music festival every weekend in Montreal. And it's just like super chill vibes like that, where it's like kind of just, you know, house tech vibes. And yeah, I love it. That brought me back to the good old days.
Nice.
We got one more here.
Like it.
From Hoor and Shia Mazel, called Can't Do This Much Longer.
I say I'm okay, but I'm not. I get nervous when put on the spot. So hyper, but really so shy. You'll think I'm all that, but I'm not. Really, I'm going through hell. Nothing is real. I'm trying to find all the little good things to be happy about. Maybe if I knew I would have been back here before, I'd try a little harder. It's no fun at all. Maybe if I knew I'd see the same damn place again, at my lowest point. Can't do this much longer.
Didn't expect that.
Yeah, I love all the like the contrast of like full on to like, and when it pulls back, his vocal is still so like raw and yeah, like a lot of energy behind it. That's cool.
Did a really good job. That type of drop could easily be, and Danny, I know you can't really hear the mix that well, but that type of drop could easily be super annoying and abrasive.
Yeah.
Because of that sound. But they did a really good job balancing that. A-SHO, what do you think?
Thanks, guys. Yeah. It's.
Well, so this is the one that's coming out on his label.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, exactly. Awesome. Yeah.
Well, I gave him positive feedback, so now I don't even feel bad.
Is Hoover a vocalist as well, or the producer?
Yeah, so Hoover's the producer, and Shia Mazel, that's the singer. He sounds like Cubs, like Urban Owl has just mentioned. Yeah, he's super talented. He's got like 1 million monthly listeners on Spotify. Like, that dude is sick. Nice. He's really talented, singer-songwriter. I think from New York, New Jersey, something like that. Maybe a collab coming through with Disco Fries in the future as well can connect some dots. But just like I think with Hoover, he's just really, really, really sick with sound design and kind of flowing through house or trap or he kind of bends genre. So
cool.
I'm stoked about it. Yeah,
awesome.
Nice. Yeah, we'll keep an eye on him. That's awesome.
Sure.
Well, before we wrap things up here today, why don't you plug socials? Tell us where people can follow you and any parting words of wisdom that you want to share.
Wow. Okay. Socials at A-SHO Official all over the place. Also check out at Tunes Nifty on Twitter and Instagram. We'll be starting to release some music NFT content on those socials. But man, yeah. Parting advice. Wow. Keep following these Disco Fries, man. These guys know what's up. You guys, appreciate you guys for having me. Like, you guys are just all around good vibes and super talented. Like, the music you guys make, I took a deep dive
into
on Spotify. Like, just awesome, awesome. High energy stuff that I love. And like, everybody, really recommend starting to kind of immerse yourselves into the Web3 space, the music NFT space. Like, give us a follow and start checking out, like, just, Googling and check out Record Shop and check out Nifty Tunes and Yeah, that's all I got to say. But thank you guys so much for having me.
Ladies and gentlemen, yeah, A-SHO.
Good conversation. I like conversation. Stuff like that where we just kind of like, I don't know, didn't, we covered like a lot of different stuff, and I feel like that's a good kind of primer for people dipping their toes into the NFT space.
Yeah, I'm a fan. Get it? Fan. Danny's got a fan behind him.
Yo, this room, like, I think it's the angle. There are actually, like, there's some decor in this room. I'm saying it like an Airbnb type thing, but like this angle I set up looks like prison cell.
A little bit. Or just, are you like near a beach? Because it's got beachy vibes.
Yeah. You say it's got beachy vibes, but it's literally all white walls and a white
I don't know fan. What about it. I think it's that type of fan I always
I'm
see.
I'm sitting in, right, like, in front of a window. And yeah, maybe it is that type of fan, but yep.
I don't know. Something about it. Cam said, you guys rock. I'm off to a gym. Thanks again for the contact. You're welcome, man. Enjoy. Hopefully you guys get can juicy. Connect on some shit. Yeah. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going over to Dope or Nope. It's not going to be seamless this week, so I'm ending this stream, and then we're restarting that stream.
We should just mention next week, is there a different time for the stream, or are we doing the same time, but it's going to be like a drop party?
A drop party is next week for the official drop. Let me see real quick.
I think we're going at one.
So I have it down starting early.
Record shop 1 to 2.
It's going to start a little early because the drop is at 1. So the plan was to be on a little early before it kicks off and then be on for the drop. But again, guys, pre-sales live right now. I know a bunch of you are in the door already on that. So thank you. Yeah. And yeah, we're super excited about this pack drop. Friends of Fries on Record Shop. Go check it out. And this is where we say bye to Danny. And I'll be back shortly. So say bye to Danny. And thanks for watching. Finish my track.